Today's topic is a question I get asked a lot, and there's a lot of interest in this topic. And that is, can Ancestry DNA be used by law enforcement? Well, let's delve into this and try to understand what might or might not be possible. Now, you may have heard about DNA being used for law enforcement purposes, and one of the first cases of commercial DNA being used for that happened just a few years ago with the Golden State Killer. Now, since that time, different companies have taken different stances on how they want to either allow this or not allow this. But today, we're talking specifically about Ancestry and whether or not law enforcement can use the Ancestry database for their investigations. Well, if we actually go to the Ancestry website, we can see right up front that Ancestry has a policy. They say, Ancestry does not voluntarily cooperate with law enforcement to provide our users with the greatest protection under the law. We require all government agencies seeking access to Ancestry customers' data to follow valid legal process and do not allow law enforcement to use Ancestry services to investigate crimes or to identify human remains. So that's pretty simple. And you would think that the answer then, of course, is going to be no. Law enforcement can't use Ancestry for any of their investigations. But I think people are concerned because there is a difference between what is allowed by the terms and conditions of the website, what maybe the law allows, and in actual practice, what somebody who, let's say, is unethical could do. So let's go over what Ancestry allows as far as DNA in their database. First off, to put your DNA into the database, you have to sign up for an account. Now, as you've seen, if you use Ancestry, this does not have to be your real name, but it can be an alias that you use there. So could an unethical law enforcement personnel sign up for an account on Ancestry with an alias without any real identifying information? Absolutely, they definitely could. Signing up for Ancestry account is free. Now, that's limited as far as what you can do with that, but it is free. So the next thing then would be getting a DNA sample into the Ancestry database. Now, Ancestry, along with 23andMe, is unique in that they don't allow transfers into their database. What that means is if you take a DNA test with, let's say, family tree DNA, you can actually download that information, and it is a spreadsheet file that has the locations and what the SNP were for that location. And you can take that information and you can upload it to a place like MyHeritage or GEDmatch. And they're reading that file with the SNP information and the SNPs to determine your matches and determine the ethnicity results and use their other tools as well. With Ancestry, they don't allow that. You can't send them a digital file and have them put that into their database. So the only way to get DNA into the Ancestry database is by taking a test. In other words, giving a sample. Now, the sample that they use is a saliva sample where you spit into a tube. When you think about law enforcement and crime scenes, most of the evidence they gather is not going to be a big pile of spit that they could scoop up and put in a test tube and send off to Ancestry. But that doesn't mean you can't still use the Ancestry test to get a sample in another way. If you actually look online, there are some people who have tested out how to do a swab with like a Q-tip and get enough of the skin cells and stuff on from your cheeks to be able to mix with some water, some purified water, to get that sample. Now, this is usually used for people who have trouble spitting. It's a, you know, legitimate concern. It's actually something that I've heard affects people as they get older much more. So there's a reason why people have looked at this process and figured out a way that they can still get people's DNA into Ancestry without that person having to spit. Now, again, they're still getting that sample from a live person and they're putting it in the preserver pretty much immediately after taking that sample. And so they have really the best chance of preserving that sample and being able to get a good DNA test from it. When we think about law enforcement, again, and we're looking at evidence being gathered from a crime scene, you're usually talking about evidence that has been sitting out for hours, sometimes days. In the case of missing bodies, that might have been weeks or even months that they're able to actually find that body and be able to get that sample. Now, the idea here is not just to get a DNA sample, but be able to match with other people. There are other methods that they can get a nice DNA sample that has all the readings that they need, but we can't transfer that into Ancestry DNA, so we actually want to get a sample to Ancestry for this. So for law enforcement, it would be very difficult to get a good sample to be able to send. Now, let's say that they do get a sample and they put this into the Ancestry vial and send it off to Ancestry. That's where they're going to come up with the next problem. Now, we've already said that they've set up this alias account that has, you know, false information, and they're sending off this sample under this account. Well, that sample has to be processed by Ancestry. And Ancestry is looking for specific things. So first off, their test is designed for saliva, basically the cells that you're finding in your mouth. So if you're taking a sample from something else, there may be other things that are corrupting it. If you read the instructions for taking a sample from Ancestry, you are supposed to not have eaten or drank anything for, I think it's 30 minutes at least. And the whole idea there is that the only DNA we're going to find in your mouth is your DNA, not the DNA of the hamburger that you ate 5 minutes ago or the wine that you just drank. But you're probably not going to find much DNA in the wine anyway because of the way that it's processed. So law enforcement putting this sample in a tube and sending it off to Ancestry. Ancestry is now going to go through and they're going to process it. Now, because of how that sample is gathered, it's not gathered in the optimal way for what Ancestry's process is designed for. In other words, it's not somebody spitting in a tube, nor is it somebody taking a swab inside of a cheek of a living person and quickly putting that in the preservative with, you know, whatever water they need to make sure that it has those cells to look at. They're taking a sample that has been sitting out possibly in the sun for days or other things, or is just old. And just the simple fact that these cells are no longer part of a living body, they are going to start to degrade. And the DNA in that is also going to start to degrade as well. So the difference here is we have a person that's just taking a test by spitting in the tube. Literally, you're talking about fractions of a second between when that spit was in their mouth to when it is in the tube with the preservative. With this unethical law enforcement hypothetical we're talking about, we're gathering a sample that has been outside of that human body for hours or days or even months and has started to degrade, and we're finally putting it in the preservative. Now, that preservative may stop the degradation at that point, but you still have all those hours and days of degradation. As Ancestry is processing this, this is going to make a difference. Some of you may have had the experience where Ancestry's emailed you back after you mailed in your sample and they said, hey, there was something wrong with the sample. We couldn't process it correctly. Can you send us another one? And so they send you another kit, you spit in it again, and you send it back. I've heard of some people that have had that happen, you know, two, maybe three times in a row. But usually it happens just once, and the second time it works. In fact, that's with 23andMe, my very first test that I took, my wife's went through perfectly and mine had problems, and so they had to send me another kit to get that new sample. So in other words, what Ancestry is looking for is they're looking for this good DNA sample that has most all the SNPs that they're expecting from it, is not degraded or anything like that. And if there is any of that showing, then they're going to flag that as, hey, there's a problem here. So we're going to send it back and ask you for another sample. Now, the other problem with DNA sampling is that with normal commercial tests, you're spitting. And since you haven't drank or ate for 30 minutes, it is just your DNA that you're spitting into that test tube. When we're gathering evidence from a crime scene, there's actually probably a pretty high likelihood it is not just your DNA. When you think about going through life, you leave bits of DNA everywhere. From your skin cells, every time you grab a doorknob, there's a little bit of DNA there. But there's also a little bit of DNA of every other person who grabs that doorknob after you until that doorknob is cleaned and wiped off and is back to not having anything on it. And the same can be said with everything else. If you look in a bathroom as far as hair, there's probably hairs from everybody in your house in your bathroom, and they're all mixed together and jumbled together. And you know, when you think about your shower, that big old clog of hair in the drain, well, that's not just one person's hair, that's everybody's hair. And that has to all be separated out if you want to try to use that for DNA. So there's a very good possibility that some of these law enforcement samples that are being sent unethically to Ancestry, and this is hypothetical, are contaminated with not just one person's DNA, but multiple people's DNA. That is going to cause problems when they're analyzing that sample, and Ancestry is going to flag that and send it to send it back and say, hey, there's a problem with this. Can we get another sample? There's that part of it. Now, the next part is when they actually, let's say they have a good clean sample, just one person's DNA, and they go through and they process it. Remember back what I said about that degradation. So a normal sample from me or you that we send off to Ancestry, they're going to look and they're going to find information on about 500,000 SNPs. And that's what their chip is set up for. With a degraded sample, there's going to be some portion of those, 5%, 10%, 25%, 30%, that it just can't identify because of that degradation. From the different companies that have submitted these law enforcement samples to GEDmatch, they have actually said in some statements that you can definitely tell a law enforcement kit from other kits from how much information has been processed. Basically what they're saying is that, hey, these law enforcement samples are not nice, pristine samples. We wouldn't expect them to be. So you don't get all of the information that you're expecting out of them. And so that's another real check, is if Ancestry does this and instead of 500,000 SNPs being called, they have 250,000 SNPs being called and 250,000 that are no calls, that's another red flag to them that, hey, this sample's got a problem with it. And so they're going to email back to the person and say, hey, there was a problem with your sample. We couldn't process it correctly. Can you send us another one? So there's all these little checks in the process that, with the way that Ancestry is set up, make it very difficult to submit a sample unethically. Now, does that mean that it can't happen? No, that doesn't mean that it can't happen. It could. And then we get to really the next part, I think. And this is one of the most important parts. If, and this is an if an unethical law enforcement personnel submitted this sample to Ancestry in violation of not only their policies, but potentially in some jurisdictions in violation of the law, and they solved the case from it, I pretty much believe that eventually it's going to come out that this is what they did. Why do I say that? Well, initially with the Golden State Killer, it was a breakthrough, and they identified this, and they didn't identify necessarily the companies by name initially, but because of the information, you pretty much knew that it was GEDmatch as the major database that they had used. At that point, people were okay knowing. Now, when I say okay, let's do that. At that point, people assumed that GEDmatch was the only one that was used. And it wasn't until a year and a half, maybe 2 years later that it came out that they'd also used MyHeritage. Again, both of these websites allow the upload of that DNA digital file. Even though MyHeritage was used as part of these law enforcement cases, surreptitiously, not necessarily with MyHeritage's knowledge, it did come out in the press eventually. And so with Ancestry DNA, if law enforcement was able to jump through all these hurdles to get a good, clean sample that they could use, after they solved the case with just the publicity, I think it would come out. Now, it may not come out immediately, but it would come out eventually. And that would be a bad thing for law enforcement, because while early on with the Golden State Killer and some of these other early ones, most of the companies were not clear as far as their policies and how they wanted DNA to be used. And there weren't really any laws in place governing this. Since that time, Ancestry and MyHeritage have taken very firm stances and very public firm stances that they do not want their DNA databases or their databases in general to be used for these purposes. That they don't allow it, that if they find it, they're going to delete that information, that they're not going to cooperate with law enforcement in any way without them going through proper legal channels. So that's why I say if law enforcement did this with some unethical conduct and possibly illegal conduct in many jurisdictions, eventually that is going to come out, and that would hinder law enforcement's ability to do some of this research in the future. In other words, yeah, you may be able to solve one case, possibly two or three, as everything's still under the radar, but once it all came out, there would be more scrutiny and more controls put in place that would lock this down completely. So do I think that any law enforcement has used Ancestry DNA up to this point to solve a case? No, I don't think so. Again, there are several different hoops that they have to jump through in order to even get into the Ancestry database. And now, because of all the publicity, I don't think it would be a risk that most law enforcement agencies would be willing to take. So saying that, Ancestry DNA has put a policy in place of not allowing law enforcement to be able to use their database, but because of Ancestry's policies as well, it would make it very difficult. Now, if you would like to learn more about DNA and law enforcement, you can watch this video up here. If you'd like to learn about something else with DNA, then why don't you watch this video down below? I've done videos about